practical reality of the thing is sometimes a factor. It was with Alan. I don't think this is a big secret anymore. You know, there was trouble in the deal making, and the idea of killing him came. Well, you know, if he doesn't want to be attached to a sequel in the contract, can't you kill him? I was like, you know what? That is not okay. You don't. You business people don't tell me what I'm supposed to. I gotta have to kill him. Artistic decisions are informed by that. I didn't kill off Oz, but he left. He said, I'm leaving the show, so we had to write him out. There are other instances where, you know, you just know far in advance that this is how you want it to roll. And you know, with Amber and with the extraordinarily underrated and darling Christine Sutherland, I told them, you know, a good long time in advance, and we spent time preparing for that. Christine knew for 2 years before it happened what was going to happen and when. If you're able to do that, obviously, it's better just for the relationship. But sometimes it's just going to be the story. Sometimes you're going to go up to somebody you really, really like. And, you know, I think I have a pretty good relationship with almost everyone I've worked with, and tell them that they're going to die or leave. You never know. You never know. One day I was like, well, I've got a tough job to do, but I've got some fun. So it's going to balance out. Because I've got to tell Mark, Lucas, you know, we're going to keep him for some episodes, but he's not going to go through the whole season next season. But I'm making Emma a regular, so it's going to be fun. I go to Mark. So, you know, after about 10 episodes, you're going to take off. I'm in more episodes? That's great! So, Emma, we're making you a regular. You mean I'm not? I went a little differently than I expected.
This is about my favorite show, Dollhouse, and it got me through one of the roughest periods of my life, and I thank you. This is about the ending. So, did you always intend to make Boyd evil, or did you have a different plan in mind before the epitaph? And if so, what were they?
I would love to stand here and say that I always intended to make Boyd evil, and I probably should. But the fact of the matter is, it came to me in the second season. We could hear the war drums, and I just sort of started thinking about it, and I was like, I love this guy, and he's such a touchstone for her character, someone she can really depend upon. So of course I thought of killing him. That's not enough. Everybody knows they do that. Why don't I take away everything? It was just the last season of Dollhouse was such a strange entity for us. I mean, the amount of talent that I was working with, the troupe, the actors, the writing staff, as good as anything. I mean, certainly as good a first year staff as I'll ever have. And, you know, in the second year, just everybody gunning to bring it. And, you know, I could sense the audiences weren't really showing up. And I could also sense that what had happened with Fox had created a hole in the show that I was having trouble with. So, you know, we started looking. And also, we had inadvertently shot an apocalypse. This was because we were sure we were canceled. Awkward. For us. But it also helped in that it informed what we were going to do. So as we started building towards the apocalypse, as we were early in the season, I said, you know, I think we could pull this one ace out of our sleeve that would actually make people's jaws hit the floor and justify it, and it would just be so much fun. Had we been a smash success, obviously Harry Lennox would not have been taken out of the picture in any way, shape, or form, because he's Harry Lennox.
Hi, in your mind, have you decided if Lila Morgan's last speech to West was her trying to let him let her go, or was it just the power to be?
Yes. And I don't say that entirely as a joke. I think, you know, Lila is one of those people who will always be working at cross purposes. There's good in her. There's she cannot not manipulate someone. And also, how much of this was going on in Wesley's head is also, there were so many things going on, but all of them are true. So the answer really is yes.
I was wondering if you ever tried to do anything as unique or genre bending as Hush or What's More Worth Feeling for the comic book?
You didn't read that issue? Anyone? Was there one? I haven't, and I'm trying to think of something. There's the death of Captain Marvel, which I think was a pretty unique specimen. And then there was that Fantastic Four that was sideways. What? But it's different for me, I think. I think also Walt Simonson did an issue of one comic with just people hitting each other. I don't think there was any talking in the entire thing. Stuff like that is really dicey. You have to, your relationship with your artist, or in his case he was the artist, has to be so close. And you have to know exactly what you're doing. I don't approach comics in that way. And I don't look for stunts to do in the television show. Like, I basically look for challenges for myself, but they have to be integral to what the show is. Hush made sense in that universe. Once More With Feeling made sense in that universe. Black and White would not. It did in the dream sequence, in the Spike's little dream part, but it didn't make sense to do a black and white episode or something like that, because there's no context for that in the lives of the people in the show. With comic books, I don't feel that same urge to sort of push the boundaries. I'm really just trying to make the story connect emotionally. And so, no, I've never really thought of something. To me, I think the closest thing would be, I think the best script I ever wrote was The Chain, issue 5 of Buffy. And it really is kind of a free associative, strange little tangent. But to me, I don't think anything else ever reached that level. And part of that was that I was so free that it was kind of like an experiment. But it isn't what I look for. I look for the moments, that bring people back. And a stunt is only as good as the stunt performer. It's tricky.
What inspired you to do this, Dr. Horrible sing-along blog?
A lot of things. Obviously, finally making it was inspired by the writer's strike and my desire to make something small that I could control. But the idea really came from, is anybody surprised that I kind of relate to villains more than heroes? Is that going to be a ripple of shock that's going to rock the con? I don't think so. People who are a little bit damaged, who are a little bit different, who are a little bit weird, and even though he's a sweet guy, ultimately misguided, they interest me so much. I wanted to make Dr. Horrible because I feel like Dr. Horrible.